Kunjabi Hari
Jaya
Come on.
Vishnupad Paramhansabhari Prajakacharya Stotras Jasvi Srimad Bhakti Vedanta Swami Prabhupada Kijaya. ISKCON Founder Acharya Srila Prabhupada Kijaya. Jayam Vishnupad Paramhansabhari Prajakacharya Stotras Jasvi Srimad Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Prabhupada Kijaya. Ananta Koti Vaishnava Vrinda Ki Jai. Namacharya Srila Haridas Thakur Ki Jai. Prem Se Kaho Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Shivas Adi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Ki Jai. Sri Sri Radha Krishna Gopa Gopinath Shama Kunda Radha Kunda Giri Govardhan Ki Jai. Vrindavan Dham Ki Jai. Navadweep Dham Ki Jai. Jamuna Mai Ki Jai. Ganga Mai Ki Jai. Tulsi Devi Ki Jai. Bhakti Devi Ki Jai. Samveta Bhakta Vrinda Ki Jai. Nitai Gaur Premanande Devo. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Glories to Srila Prabhupada.
Hare Krishna, everyone.
Hare Krishna.
Welcome to Shishi Radha Vrindeshwara's temple this evening. It's a very nice evening where we have a very auspicious presence of His Holiness, Giriraj Maharaj. I think most of you are familiar or know Maharaj, but just for those who don't and for those who do, let's just stimulate our appreciation by hearing a little about Maharaj, that he's one of ISKCON's most senior members. He joined in 1969 in ISKCON, Boston. My own spiritual master was Holiness Sasu Maharaj. And then after some time there, Srila Prabhupada took him to India. We became one of the integral members of the ISKCON's most challenging and fun period of the purchase and development of Hare Krishna land in Juhu. And if anybody ever wonders about their austerities in their service, then you just have to read what was involved in getting Hare Krishna land and the Juhu temple together, and then you find out what austerities are about. So Giriraj Maharaj is one of those that was on that project for many, many years. And then he became, after Srila Prabhupada left, he became sannyas in GBC. And presently now, he's focusing his time in when his health permits, and in between traveling still, he writes these books. So you can see a number of books there. His Watering the Seed book is a book about Prabhupada stories. Many Moons about departed Vaishnavas. And the recent book called Life's Final Exam, correct? Life's Final Exam?
Yeah.
Yes. About the Vaishnava attitude on dying, on practical aspects of this most important test in life, being of the body. So we're very glad Maharaj is here. It's been a few years since he's been to Seoul Street, and I think he's just coming back from India, Maharaj?
Yes.
Okay. I'll come back from India. I'll be back this gate. So let us heartily express our appreciation of Maharaj with the present by three loud Hari Bol.
Hari Bol! Hari Bol! Hari Bol!
So in this Giriraj Maharaj, please.
Jai!
Thank you.
Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo 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 Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Shri Radha Landanishwara ki
jai.
Shri Jagannath Baladev Subhadra ki
jai.
So read from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 2, Chapter 4, The Process of Creation. Text 18. Kirata hunandra pulinda pulkasha abirashumba yavana kashadaya yanye chapapa yadapa shraya shraya sudyanti tasmai prabha vishnave namaha. Kirata hunandra pulinda pulkasha Abhira shumbha yavana kashadaya Yanye chapapa yadapa shraya shraya Sudyanti tasmai prabha vishnave namaha. Please repeat. Kirata.
Kirata,
a province of old Bharata.
A province of old Bharata.
Huna.
Huna,
part of Germany and Russia.
Part of Germany and Russia.
Andhra.
Andhra,
a province of southern India.
A province of southern India.
Pulinda.
Pulinda,
the Greeks.
The Greeks.
Pulkasha.
Pulkasha,
another province.
Another province.
Yavana.
Yavana,
the Turks.
The Turks.
Kashadaya.
Kashadaya,
the Mongolian province.
The Mongolian province.
Ye.
Ye,
even those.
Even those.
Anye.
Anye,
others.
Others.
Cha.
Cha,
also.
Also.
Papa.
Papa,
addicted to sinful acts.
Addicted to sinful acts.
Yet.
Yet.
Whose.
Whose.
Apashraya ashraya.
Apashraya ashraya.
Having taken shelter of the devotees of the Lord.
Having taken shelter of the devotees of the Lord.
Shudyanti.
Shudyanti,
at once purified.
At once purified.
Tasmai.
Tasmai,
unto him.
Unto him.
Prabha Vishnave.
Prabha Vishnave,
unto the powerful Vishnu.
Unto the powerful Vishnu.
Namaha.
Namaha.
My respectful obeisances.
My respectful obeisances.
Translation. Kirata Huna Andhra Pulinda Pulkasha Abhira Shumbha Yavana, members of the Kasa races, and even others addicted to sinful acts, can be purified by taking shelter of the devotees of the Lord, due to the Lord's being the supreme power. I beg to offer my respectful obeisances unto him. Please repeat. Kirata Huna Andhra.
Kirata Huna Andhra.
Pulinda Pulkasha Abhira.
Pulinda Pulkasha
Abhira. Shumbha Yavana.
Shumbha Yavana,
members of the Khasa race,
members of the Khasa race,
and even others addicted to sinful acts,
and even others addicted to sinful acts,
can be purified. By taking shelter of the devotees of the Lord.
By taking shelter of the devotees of the Lord.
Due to the Lord's being the supreme power.
Due to the Lord's being the supreme power.
I beg to offer my respectful obeisances.
I beg to offer my respectful obeisances.
Unto him.
Unto him.
Purport by Srila Prabhupada. Kirata, a province of old Bharatvarsha, mentioned in the Bhishma Parva of Mahabharata. Generally, the Kiratas are known as the aboriginal tribes of India. Huna, the area of East Germany and part of Russia is known as the province of the Hunas. Accordingly, sometimes a kind of hill tribe is known as the Hunas. Andhra, a province in southern India mentioned in the Bhishma Parva of Mahabharata. It is still extant under the same name. Pulinda. The Greeks are known as Pulindas, as it is mentioned in the Vana Parva of Mahabharata, that the non-Vedic race of this part of the world would rule over the world. The Pulinda province was also one of the provinces of Bharata, and the inhabitants were classified amongst the Kshatriya kings. But later on, due to their giving up the Brahminical culture, they were mentioned as Mlechas, just as those who are not followers of the Islamic culture are called Kafirs, and those who are not followers of the Christian culture are called heathens. Can we come forward to make room for others? Please come forward. Abira. It is mentioned that this province was situated on the river Saraswati in Sindh. The modern Sindh province formerly extended on the other side of the Arabian Sea, and all the inhabitants of that province were known as Abiras. They were under the domination of Maharaj Yudhisthira, and according to the statements of Markandeya, the Mlechas of this part of the world would also rule over Bharat. Later on, this proved to be true, as in the case of the Pulindas. On behalf of the Pulindas, Alexander the Great conquered India. And on behalf of the Abiras, Muhammad Ghori conquered India. These Abiras were also formerly Kshatriyas within the Brahminical culture, but they gave up the connection. The Kshatriyas who were afraid of Parasaram and had hidden themselves in the Caucasian hilly regions later on became known as the Abiras, and the place they inhabited was known as Abira Desh. Sumbas or Kankas, the inhabitants of the conquered province of Old Bharat, mentioned in the Mahabharata. Yavanas. Yavana was the name of one of the sons of Maharaj Yayati, who was given the part of the world known as Turkey to rule. Therefore, the Turks are Yavanas due to being descendants of Maharaj Yavana. The Yavanas were therefore Kshatriyas, and later on, by giving up the Brahminical culture, they became Mlecha Yavanas. Descriptions of the Yavanas are in the Mahabharata Adi Parva 85-34. It is also foretold that these Yavanas would conquer India, and it proved to be true. Kasha. The inhabitants of the Kasha Desh are mentioned in the Mahabharata, Drona Parva. Those who have a stunted growth of hair on the upper lip are generally called Kasas. As such, the Kasas are the Mongolians, the Chinese, and others who are so designated. The above mentioned historical names are different nations of the world. Even those who are constantly engaged in sinful acts are all corrigible to the standard of perfect human beings if they take shelter of the devotees of the Lord. Jesus Christ and Muhammad, two powerful devotees of the Lord, have done tremendous service on behalf of the Lord on the surface of the globe. And from the version of Srila Shukadeva Goswami, it appears that instead of running a godless civilization in the present context of the world situation, if the leadership of world affairs is entrusted to the devotees of the Lord, for which a worldwide organization under the name and style of the International Society for Krishna Consciousness has already been started, then by the grace of the Almighty Lord, there can be a thorough change of heart in human beings all over the world, because the devotees of the Lord are able authorities to effect such a change by purifying the dust-worn minds of the people in general. The politicians of the world may remain in their respective positions because the pure devotees of the Lord are not interested in political leadership or diplomatic implications. The devotees are interested only in seeing that the people in general are not misguided by political propaganda, and in seeing that the valuable life of a human being is not spoiled in following a type of civilization which is ultimately doomed. If the politicians, therefore, would be guided by the good counsel of the devotees, and certainly there would be a great change in the world's situation by the purifying propaganda of the devotees, as shown by Lord Chaitanya. As Shukadev Goswami began his prayer by discussing the word yat kirtanam, so also Lord Chaitanya recommended that simply by glorifying the Lord's holy name, a tremendous change of heart can take place, by which the complete misunderstanding between the human nations created by politicians can at once be extinguished. And after the extinction of the fire of misunderstanding, other prophets will follow. The destination is to go back home, back to Godhead. as we have several times discussed in these pages. So the purport continues, but I will stop here to discuss what we have just read. The basic idea is that members of all sorts of communities, and even others who are addicted to sinful acts, can be purified to the highest standard of pure devotee by what? Raise your hands. Yes.
Being in touch with the Supreme Lord.
That is true. But what is the specific method mentioned in the verse? Taking shelter of the devotees of the Lord. But it is true that when one does take shelter of the devotees will engage one in kirtan, in the various processes of devotional service, beginning with kirtan. So, pretty much historically, the Vaishnavas who wrote commentaries on the scripture wrote in relation to the individual practitioner. Srila Prabhupada's Sanskrit editor, Pradyumna Das, who was very learned in Sanskrit language and also in Vedic literature, said that one thing that distinguished Srila Prabhupada was that he extended the principles of the scripture, which are generally read by people to apply in their own lives, but it was extended by Srila Prabhupada to a national or actually global level. So we know from the Shikshastaka prayers, Cheto Darpano Bharjanam, by chanting the holy names of the Lord, all the dirt accumulated within the heart becomes cleansed. But here Srila Prabhupada is saying that if the governments of the world are guided by devotees, this verse is about how by taking shelter of devotees, anyone can be purified. So Srila Prabhupada is saying that if the leaders of the world take guidance from devotees, then they can introduce Sankirtan on a large scale. And by kirtan, the consciousness of the people in general will be purified. So Cheto Darpano Marjanam Bhava Mahata Vagni Nirvapanam. By chanting the holy names, the blazing fire of material existence is extinguished. So Srila Prabhupada is saying if the world leaders are guided by devotees, then the blazing fire of material existence in the form of misunderstandings and conflicts between different nations and different groups will be extinguished, and then other benefits will follow. So Srila Prabhupada had a very broad mission, and he wanted us to cooperate with him. So I'll continue. According to the cult of devotion, generally known as the Vaishnav cult, there is no bar against anyone's advancing in the matter of God realization. A Vaishnav is powerful enough to turn into a Vaishnav, even the Kirata, etc., as above mentioned. In the Bhagavad Gita, it is said by the Lord that there is no bar to becoming a devotee of the Lord, even for those who are low-born, or women, Shudras, or Vaishyas. And by becoming a devotee, everyone is eligible to return home, back to Godhead. The only qualification is that one takes shelter of a pure devotee of the Lord, who has thorough knowledge in the transcendental science of Krishna, Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam. Well, the only qualification is that one takes shelter of a pure devotee of the Lord. One time in Bombay, one of Srila Prabhupada's most prominent disciples, Tamal Krishna Goswami, needed a hernia operation. And so he went to what was the best hospital in Mumbai at the time, which was founded by a friend of ours, to have the operation performed. But Srila Prabhupada wanted to stop the operation because he didn't trust the Indian doctors then. And he tried to phone the hospital, but he could not get through. So he decided to go personally to try to stop the operation. And for the first years in India, we didn't have any motor vehicles of our own, but then eventually we got a Jeep, which was, it had a metal body, but then it had like a canvas covering on it and sort of open sides. So Srila Prabhupada got in the Jeep and drove down to the hospital. But when he got there, it was too late. The surgery had already been performed, and Tamal Krishna Goswami was just being wheeled out of the operation theater, or the recovery room. And he was just coming out of the effects of the anesthesia. And he opened his eyes and he saw Srila Prabhupada. And he told Srila Prabhupada that he had just had a dream. And in the dream, Srila Prabhupada was giving a report to the previous acharyas about how his work was going on the planet Earth. And Srila Prabhupada told the previous acharyas that the people on Earth now have no good qualities. They have no background in pious activities. They have no knowledge of spiritual culture. And pretty much they have no interest in spiritual life at all. So they have no qualification. But they do have one good quality. And that is that they have faith in me. And whatever I tell them, they do. And because of that one good quality, they can be delivered. And then Tamal Krishna Goswami looked to Srila Prabhupada to see if he would confirm or disconfirm the dream. And Srila Prabhupada nodded his head and agreed, yes, it is true. So such a powerful devotee is extraordinarily rare. In fact, no one in the history of the world did what Srila Prabhupada did. And no one else will, because yes, Srila Prabhupada crossed the ocean and went to all these different places mentioned and engaged, accepted people from any background and engaged them in the process of devotional service. Please try to come forward a little more so others can squeeze in.
Yeah, there's space, there's space.
Srila Prabhupada built a house the whole world can live in. And not only did Srila Prabhupada inspire people from all over the world to take to devotional service, but he also had to contend with many enemies of the Krishna consciousness movement. Many people who complained that Srila Prabhupada was accepting disciples from different castes and communities and engaging them as Brahmins, as sannyasis. In fact, in Hyderabad, which is in the some of the caste Brahmins complained to Srila Prabhupada that he was ruining the Hindu religion by accepting people who were not born as Brahmins. As Brahmins. Once when we were in Madras, We means Srila Prabhupada had received an invitation to Madras, but he didn't go personally. So a small party of four of us went. And our host said that we are not Brahmins. He said that we're Vaishnavas, and Vaishnavas are higher than Brahmins, but we're not Brahmins. For us to be Brahmins, we have to take birth in our next lives in Brahmin families. So one of the members of our small group was Achyutananda Swami. And Achyutananda Swami asked the host, what is more powerful, sin or Krishna's name? And the gentleman had to admit Krishna's name is more powerful. And then he said, why is someone born in a Brahmin family? Why is someone born in another family? It is because of their past activities, past pious and sinful activities. But the holy name of Krishna is so powerful it destroys the reactions to all of one's past activities. And therefore, the results of one's past activities as manifested in the family of one's birth no longer holds. And he had to accept that it was true. And the same fact is corroborated in Srimad Bhagavatam, that even those born in families of dog eaters, if they chant the holy names of the Lord, they're immediately eligible to perform Vedic sacrifices. Ordinarily, even someone born in a Brahmin family has to undergo certain purificatory rituals to be eligible to perform Vedic sacrifices, but one who chants the holy name of the Lord is immediately eligible. So, yeah, Srila Prabhupada was constantly contending with these types of opponents. When we first came to Bombay, there was a press conference, and in the press conference, or in the coverage, it was reported that one of the devotees named Gopal, who's actually in Vrindavan now, that Gopal had worked as a construction worker before he came to Krishna consciousness. So someone wrote a letter to the editor saying that someone who works in construction is considered a sudra. So how can a sudra be a Brahmin? And so Srila Prabhupada had us write back, basically establishing the fact that anyone, no matter what his previous position was, can become a devotee and a Vaishnava and a Brahmin. So it's actually because of Srila Prabhupada that all of us are here now. If it weren't for him, we wouldn't be here. And we wouldn't be worshiping the deity and engaging all of the different activities of devotional service. But I will continue because there's more. So we just read that anyone who's conversant in the science of Krishna can accept as a disciple anyone from any part of the world. Then Srila Prabhupada writes, anyone from any part of the world who becomes well conversant in the science of Krishna becomes a pure devotee and a spiritual master for the general mass of people and may reclaim them by purification of heart. So not only can a spiritual master reclaim anyone from any part of the world, but he can train anyone from any part of the world to become conversant in the science of Krishna, and that person can become a spiritual master who in turn can reclaim people from any part of the world. And so the parampara can continue in the same way. Though a person be even the most sinful man, he can at once be purified by systematic contact with a pure Vaishnava. A Vaishnava, therefore, can accept a bona fide disciple from any part of the world without any consideration of caste or creed, and promote him by regulative principles to the status of a pure Vaishnava who is transcendental to Brahminical culture. By regulative principles, it's not just that one cheaply gives initiation or cheaply gives the sacred thread, but one is elevated by following the regulative principles. The system of caste or Varnashram Dharma is no longer regular even amongst the so-called followers of the system. I think it was 1977, Srila Prabhupada was in Juhu, and one of the political leaders of India, Jayaprakash Narayan, held a big meeting in which he called upon all the Brahmins to take off their sacred threads and place them in a bonfire, to sort of, indicate that the Brahmins were not going to, that everyone was equal, that the Brahmins were not going to exercise any artificial domination over the others. So many lakhs of Brahmins came forward and took off their sacred threads and put it in the fire. And Srila Prabhupada said, good, they're admitting they're all sudras. So that's what he writes here. The system of caste or Varnashram Dharma is no longer regular even amongst the so-called followers of the system. Nor is it now possible to reestablish the institutional function in the present context of social, political, and economic revolution. Without any reference to the particular custom of a country, one can be accepted to the Vaishnava cult spiritually, and there is no hindrance in the transcendental process. So by the order of Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, what is the order of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? Yes, actually I think there are two orders that are relevant here. One is, can you say loudly?
Amara kya hai ho
guru
guru hona taro ei desh jare dekho tare kaho krishna upadesh,
which means
chant the holy name of krishna.
Well, that's the conclusion of everything. But Amar Agyai Guru Hai means, on my order, you become a guru. Amar Agyai Guru. Tare Desh. Yare Deke Tare Kaho Krishna Upadesh. And repeat the message of Krishna. And what was the other one? Okay. Well, we'll read what Srila Prabhupada says. This is the answer. So by the order of Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the cult of Srimad Bhagavatam, or the Bhagavad Gita, can be preached all over the world, reclaiming all persons willing to accept the transcendental cult. Such cultural propaganda by the devotees will certainly be accepted by all persons who are reasonable and inquisitive, without any particular bias for the custom of the country. A Vaishnav never accepts another Vaishnav on the basis of birthright, just as he never thinks of the deity of the Lord in a temple as an idol. So this is an indirect reference to a verse from the Padma Purana that says that anyone who considers the deity to be made of stone, or a Vaishnav to belong to a particular caste or community, has a hellish mentality. In other words, it is forbidden. It is forbidden to think of the deity as being made of stone or metal or wood. And it is forbidden to see a Vaishnav as belonging to a particular caste or community. One must see the deity as Krishna, and one must see a Vaishnav as servant of Krishna, without any material consideration or calculation. And this is very important for all of us in our dealings with each other, to see each other as Krishna's servants and not as belonging to any caste or community. The Vaishnav never accepts another Vaishnav on the basis of birthright, just as he never thinks of the deity of the Lord in a temple as an idol. And to remove all doubts in this connection, Srila Shukadev Goswami has invoked the blessings of the Lord, who is all-powerful, Prabhu Vishnave Namaha. The all-powerful Lord accepts the humble service of his devotee in devotional activities of the Archana, his form as the worshipable deity in the temple. Similarly, the body of a pure Vaishnava changes transcendentally at once when he gives himself up to the service of the Lord and is trained by a qualified Vaishnava. So this is confirmed by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in his instructions to Srila Sanatana Goswami. Sanatana Goswami had contracted a disease, a skin disease that was oozing foul liquid, and consequently he was avoiding Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu because Lord Chaitanya would embrace him and all this liquid would come on the Lord's body. And Srila Sanatana Goswami was so distressed that he was prepared to give up his life. And Lord Chaitanya told him Diksha Kale, at the time of Diksha, when a devotee gives himself up to the service of the Lord in full surrender, the Lord accepts him to be on the same level. In other words, he accepts him on the spiritual platform. So this is stated here. The body of a pure Vaishnav, the body of a pure Vaishnav changes transcendentally at once when he gives himself up to the service of the Lord and is trained by a qualified Vaishnav. The injunction of Vaishnav regulation in this connection runs as follows. Archye Vishno Shila Dir Guru Shu Naramatir Vaishnave Jata Buddhi Shri Vishnur Namni Shabda Samanya Buddhi, etc. One should not consider the deity of the Lord as worship in the temple to be an idol, nor should one consider the authorized spiritual master an ordinary man, nor should one consider a pure Vaishnav to belong to a particular caste, etc. Padma Purana. The conclusion is that the Lord, being all-powerful, can, under any and every circumstance, accept anyone from any part of the world, either personally or through his bona fide manifestation as the spiritual master. Lord Chaitanya accepted many devotees from communities other than the Varnashramites. So what's an example of a devotee who Lord Chaitanya accepted from outside the community of Varnashramites? Yes, Namacharya Srila Haridas Thakur. Lord Chaitanya accepted many devotees from communities other than the Varnashramites, and he himself declared to teach us that he does not belong to any caste or social order of life, but he is the eternal servant of the Lord, who maintains the damsels of Vrindavan, that is Lord Krishna. Who knows the verse? You can see Srila Prabhupada, he writes with such conviction and realization, it seems as if he's just speaking from his heart, and he is speaking from his heart. But he's also thinking in terms of verses and paraphrasing the verses in the purport. So who knows the verse that Srila Prabhupada just paraphrased here? Louder, with confidence. And then Gopi Bhartu Padakamayor Dasa Dasa. I'm not a Brahmin, I'm not a Kshatriya, I'm not a Vaishya, I'm not a Shudra. I'm not a brahmachari or a grihastha or a vanaprastha or a sannyasi, but I'm the servant of the servant of the servant of Krishna, the maintainer of the gopis of Vrindavan. And then Srila Prabhupada concludes, that is the way of self-realization. Now, I may add that although Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has confirmed his identity as not belonging to any varna or ashram, but as being the servant of the servant of the servant of Krishna, and although it is enjoined that one should not see a Vaishnava as belonging to any caste or community, but only as a servant of Krishna, because we are still somewhat conditioned, we also do have to give some consideration to Varnashram Dharma. Varnashram Dharma means one's natural position in the social and spiritual orders. Otherwise, if we neglect that aspect, we may come into difficulty. One example in one context. When Lord Krishna was residing in Dwarka, his principal queen was Rukmini. And one day he told Rukmini that I am not qualified to be your husband. And then he went on to enumerate her various good qualities. And then by contrast, he said he had none of those good qualities, and in fact, it's not even known what caste he belongs to, whether he's a cowherd boy or a prince, and he went on. He was teasing her. He wanted her to respond. But the thought of Krishna leaving her was so shocking to her and so terrifying to her that she just fainted. But in the commentary, Srila Prabhupada and other acharyas explain that actually for a marriage to work well, it's good if the husband and wife are of similar qualities and qualifications. So although as Vaishnavas we're all eternal servants of Krishna, but when we deal with the material world, we have to consider our material qualities. And a relationship like that of husband and wife, it's sort of a combination between material and spiritual. Of course, we hope that it will become more and more spiritual. And so in such a situation, we can't just say, oh, he's a devotee or she's a devotee, so it'll be all right. I mean, it might be, but it may also be worth considering, you know, compatibility, as they say. So now, I wanted to get to the body of the purport, so I didn't spend much time on these different countries and people of different countries. But I thought I'll just mention one, Srila Prabhupada writes, on behalf of the Pulindas, Alexander the Great conquered India. So we see that there's a lot of conquering of India by different invaders. Anyway, that's another topic, but although they may have conquered in a certain way, but spiritually they could not conquer India. And Srila Prabhupada related a story of Alexander the Great, that when he came to the precincts of India, there was a yogi in meditation in the hot sun. And Alexander the Great was very impressed. He was just sitting in meditation in the hot sun. So he got down and he told the yogi, "I'm Alexander the Great, I'm the conqueror of the world. I'm very impressed with you. And I'm ready to give you anything that you ask." And the yogi replied, "I only want one thing from you. Please move out of the way because you're blocking the sun." In other words, you're casting a shadow that's interfering with my austerities. And Alexander the Great sent back a message to his commanders who were following him that the people of this place are very special and don't mess with them. They're special people. Srila Prabhupada actually quoted that story to me when I first came to the Boston Temple. I was coming every night, and Srila Prabhupada's program was Monday, Wednesday, and Thursday. He would speak in the temple. And Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday, he would speak outside, usually at a university or else at some hall or other venue. And Sunday was the Sunday feast. So I had, before coming to Krishna consciousness, I had the idea of serving humanity. And then when I came to Srila Prabhupada, I learned about serving God, that the real process was to serve God. But still, I was wondering about serving humanity. So I asked him. And Srila Prabhupada replied that to give someone something that makes him so satisfied that he doesn't want anything else, is that not service? And he had just spoken on the verse, "Savai pung samparo dharmo yato bhaktirat hoksaje, ai tukhi apityata yayatma supracedati," that only by unmotivated and uninterrupted devotional service can one satisfy one's soul. And then he told the story of Dhruva Maharaj, how he went to the forest to get his kingdom, but in the end he got God, he got Krishna, and he was so satisfied that he didn't want anything else. So he said, "Is this not service to give someone something that makes him so satisfied he doesn't want anything else?" And he quoted the story of the yogi and Alexander. He was so satisfied he didn't want anything that Alexander the Great could offer. So that is the nature of pure devotional service, that when one has it, one doesn't want anything else, but one is fully satisfied. Fully satisfied means he doesn't want anything but service. Not that he's satisfied, okay, now I've done enough service, now I can take rest, but satisfied in the sense that he doesn't want anything except service, but he wants more and more and more service. So, yes, we've received a tremendous mercy to be engaged in devotional service, and as Srila Prabhupada says here, and as he has repeatedly said, we should also share that good fortune with others. And that is the Shri Shri Radha Landanishwara Ki Jai, Shri Jagannath Baladev Subhadra Ki Jai, Shri Shri Gaurani Kai. That is the only way we can attempt to repay our debt to him for what he has given us. So are there any questions or comments? Yes? Do we have a second microphone?
One of them. Technology, because now that technology is coming to play a lot more, and it's going to probably outbalance the natural intake that we have in life. Do you have any ideas around the reapproach to this new generation that we're going into now?
You're saying that technology is becoming more prominent? And it's disturbing the natural balance of nature?
I believe it would be for nature, yes.
Yes. And so what is the question?
Well, do you have maybe an approach or any ideas?
Oh, an approach.
Yes, keeping that balance.
Well, Srila Prabhupada wanted us to have self-sufficient farm communities in which devotees would be, you know, able to live simply and naturally and advance in Krishna consciousness. And, you know, there are a number of farm communities. But the two that seem to be the most advanced in terms of really becoming self-sufficient are New Vraja Dham in Hungary. I could explain it in detail, but they're really producing most of what they need to eat. And they produce a lot of their own energy, and they even, have their own water, and they take care of the cows. I mean, it's a wonderful project. And I recently visited the Govardhan Eco Village near Bombay. And that's also very nice. I mean, the sort of like one of the centerpieces of the whole project is the waste processing plant. How even human waste can be processed, and that you know, water can be used for irrigating the fields, and So that's the first thing, to have examples. And you know, by nature's way, things go in cycles. And so there is a growing awareness of the ill effects of the modern technological civilization. And so people are hankering for a more simple life, depending on nature and the cows. So I think whatever, actually there's no reason to be in the city unless we're preaching. There's really no reason. Otherwise, it's much better to be in the country. Srila Prabhupada quoted the British poet Cowper that man created the cities and God created the country. So, yeah.
Hare Krishna. I wanted to ask, you mentioned in the class about in society, Varnashram currently, you said because of the political, economical, and social aspects, it's not possible at the moment. But what are the favorable conditions for that to come about?
Yes, what Srila Prabhupada wrote was that the system of caste or varnashram dharma is no longer regular even amongst the so-called followers of the system, nor is it now possible to reestablish the institutional function in the context of social, political, and economic revolution. So everyone's in the mood of revolution. They don't want any authority, they don't want any hierarchy, they don't want anyone to be above them, they want to be equal. And Varnashram Dharma means, and it's natural, as Prabhupada says, the weak serve the strong. So, but in that mood, you can't introduce Varnashram Dharma, but if everyone becomes Krishna conscious, then it doesn't matter in one sense, because then everyone's engaged in serving Krishna according to their propensity or capability.
Initiation, Vaishnavas, they get this Brahminical initiation. Should we try to develop Brahminical qualities, or Vaishnavas qualities are more higher? Then why we have this Brahminical initiation?
Good question. Very good question. Actually, Vaishnav is higher than Brahman, because pure Vaishnav is transcendental even to the material mode of goodness, whereas a Brahman is predominantly in the material mode of goodness. But in the material world, no mode exists in its pure state. It's always mixed with the other modes. So even though a Brahman is primarily in the mode of goodness, but there will be some little influence of passion and ignorance. So a pure Vaishnav is transcendental even to the position of a Brahman or the mode of goodness.
Okay.
But Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur introduced the system of giving brahminical initiation to Vaishnavas so that people would not misunderstand the Vaishnavas and think that they were less than Brahmins. And so he awarded brahminical initiation to his disciples, even who were not born in Brahmin families, to establish the fact that they are Brahmins and Vaishnavas. And what was the first part of your question?
How we apply the verse you read, it's obvious for us because we can only have this mercy of spiritual master and association of devotees because we cannot be brahmanas or shudras, we are mlechhas here. So how we should understand it for us?
I'm not sure what the question is. That you're saying that we're nothing in the Varnashram system.
Yes.
You know, it's only by the mercy of Srila Prabhupada and the devotees of Srila Prabhupada that we can have any position in Varnashram Dharma. Yes.
I'm sorry, Maharaj. I lost my.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay.
I remember her question.
Okay.
She said, "How people in the West can adapt the Varnashram." Understand the
Varnashram. Oh. Well, we can understand it by reading Srila Prabhupada's books. But there's Daiva Varnashram, which means performing one's duty for Krishna. And in that sense, any devotee who performs his duty or her duty for the pleasure of Krishna is engaged in Daivi Varnashram. And in Daivi Varnashram, there's really no need to designate someone as Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, or Sudra because they're all serving Krishna. So they're all Krishna Das or Krishna Dasi. But just for organization, they may perform different functions, but they're not anything of the material world. They're Krishna's servants. Yes.
So you were speaking about how not to see Vaishnava as an ordinary way. Does that mean that we have these two terms that there's Nitya Mukta and Nitya Bada? So does it mean that all the Vaishnavas are Nitya Mukta? The all of them is right. What is the meaning of these two terms?
Well, there are different terms. But yes, we say Nitya Mukta because when one is liberated then he's in his constitutional position and that's eternal. When we say Nitya Baddha, eternally conditioned, not really eternally conditioned but because no one can really trace out the beginning, so we say eternally conditioned but it's not really eternal. And then, you know, in terms of perfection, there's Nitya Siddhas, eternally perfect, and Sadhana Siddhas, those who become perfect by sadhana, by practice. And then there are Kripa Siddhas, those who become perfect by mercy. So it doesn't mean that someone who's accepted into devotional service and initiated, it doesn't mean that the person's Nitya Siddha. I mean, it may not be Siddha at all at that stage, but he could be in the process of becoming Sadhana Siddha.
So then, where does this point come in where Krishna Siddha is due? Is this point you made earlier about them becoming Krishna Siddha in an ordinary way, we should see Vaishnavas in an ordinary way. So that's applicable to the Sadhana Siddha.
Yes, that's right. I mean, a Vaishnav is not ordinary. Even if the Vaishnav is just beginning, but still, it's very special to be engaged in Krishna's service. And there are many statements that even neophyte devotees liberated, and even a neophyte devotee is more advanced than the most advanced karmi or gyani or yogi. So yeah, devotees are very precious and rare. Yes?
My question would be that in the lecture we covered a lot of topics about humanity and environmental friendly thinking. And thank you very much.
And it's working, sorry. And I know that, first of all, the answer of Srila Prabhupada would be that Krishna consciousness is bringing with itself the solutions for these kind of problems, like renewing the environment and humanity. But my question would be, till that point this arrives, is ISKCON ready to work together with other religions or with people out of Krishna consciousness for a higher purpose, for example, about environmental friendly projects?
Well, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur says that a pure devotee is interested in pure devotion, whatever tradition it comes in. So he can go to an assembly of Christians or Muslims, and as long as they are not engaged in the pursuit of economic development or sense gratification or impersonal liberation, he can find that association to be very favorable. But even an assembly of Hindus, or even some sort of Vaishnavs, but if they have material motives, you know, for economic development, sense gratification, or impersonal liberation, then he will not find that association congenial. So it's really not so much a matter of the tradition, but the consciousness of the followers. You know, as far as cooperating for some material objective, I mean, that's always there. Say you have a business and a Christian comes into your store, you're not going to refuse to sell him your product because he's a Christian or a Muslim or So, you know, cooperating to help the environment, it's, I mean, it's a good cause, but it is material. Without Krishna, it's material. And, you know, what the significance of New Vraja Dham or the Govardhan Eco Village, the significance is to lead a simple life so one can be Krishna conscious. The idea is not to make the world a happy place, because the world can never become a happy place. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Dukhalayam Ashashvatam, that this material world is full of misery and temporary. So we're not trying to make Dukhalayam, a place of misery, into Sukhalayam, a place of happiness. It's not possible. But what we are trying to do is to create an environment that's favorable to Krishna consciousness, so we can get out of the material world and go back home, back to Godhead. You understand? We're not utopians. We're not trying to make, you know, as one devotee said, we're not trying to put whipped cream on stool.
Yes, thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Yes.
As you read, Srila Prabhupada mentioned creating understanding, which is
mm-hmm.
the opposite of misunderstanding,
mm-hmm.
which is not the utopian thing, but
no,
understanding.
That's spiritual understanding.
To allow peacefulness, which is necessary, and work in peacefulness, so that one can engage in spiritual consciousness.
Yes.
Yes. That's very good. That's it. Thank you.
Perfect. You have understood. Correct. Yes.
Hare Bol Maharaj. I just wanted to ask, in regards to Vaishnavas, we say Lord Shiva is one of the greatest Vaishnavas, but when it comes to like celebrating like Mahashivaratri, we don't do anything. Whereas when it comes to any of the Goswamis or anything like that, then we will observe a fast for their appearance or disappearance. So is there any reason why we do not do anything like for any of the demigods, so Lord Shiva or you know, Mother Durga, when we consider them demigods and devotees of the Lord, but we only follow, we only observe something for when it comes to the Goswamis or Acharyas?
Well, we follow the Mahajans, Mahajaniyena Gatasa Pantha, and our Acharyas, and especially Rupa Goswami, have given us directions what holidays to observe and how to observe them. Although Lord Shiva and the other demigods are devotees in one aspect, but in another aspect they're demigods. And in pure devotional service we don't worship demigods. So we may internally understand Vaishnava Nam Yata Shambhu, that Lord Shiva is a great Vaishnava. But if ordinary people see us worshipping Lord Shiva, they'll think, oh, in ISKCON they also worship demigods, so we can also worship demigods. Any other questions or comments? Yes?
Dear Maharaj, thank you for your lecture. I was wondering, because when we look in the past of Vaishnava culture and tradition, we can see that there were many acharyas and gurus, who made some new changes, or I mean, as you said, somebody introduced this, somebody introduced that. Let's say Srila Prabhupada introduced this to the West, right, and simplified many things for us. Let's say he allowed us to chant 16 rounds instead of 64. So, what is your prediction in the future? Well, if we follow Prabhupada, it's okay. But maybe if that means if acharyas can change so many things, what will happen in the future with Krishna consciousness? What is your prediction? Thank you very much.
Well, the acharyas don't change things, but they make adjustments. And there's a big difference. Some of Srila Prabhupada's godbrothers, you know, complain that Srila Prabhupada, for example, was allowing men and women to preach together. And so Prabhupada's servant, Shruti Kirti Das, said to Srila Prabhupada that, we have faith in you that you have preserved the basic principles and only made adjustments in the details. But how do we distinguish what is a principle and what is a detail? And Srila Prabhupada replied, that requires a little intelligence. So that is the rule, that we keep the basic principles and only make adjustments in the details. And acharyas like Srila Prabhupada and Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, they were empowered to do that. But we're not. So we just follow what they gave us. And if we do that, then the future is very bright. Like once there was a conference in Bombay at the Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan. And the topic of the conference was how all of the world's problems could be solved by the Bhagavad Gita. And before the conference began, the organizer, Shrimati Lilavati Munshi, she invited all the participants into her quarters for a discussion. And she was amazed by what Srila Prabhupada had done. You know, she kept asking, how did you do that? How did you get them to give up eating meat, fish, and eggs? How did you get them to chant Hare Krishna? How did you get them to wear dhotis and kurtas and saris? And it just went on and on. Like, how did you do it? How did you do it? But then she brought up the question, and many people had the same question, because Srila Prabhupada was already quite elderly when he began. So she brought up, what is the future of the movement? And he said, as long as they follow my instructions, the future will be very bright. They're just like Gandhiji. He had so many programs, but then afterwards, Nehru did everything different. Like he went against Gandhi's program. So he was saying, if they follow what I have given them, then the future will be very bright. But if they go against what I have given, then what can I do? But that was in one context, but otherwise, in general, he did have faith that we would continue it, and we are continuing it. So, I think it will continue for the next 10,000 years at least. Srila Prabhupada ki
jai.
Srila Prabhupada Anugas ki
jai.
So maybe we'll end on this note.
Okay. On behalf of Jani Taipu, who can't be here, and all the devotees, thank you very much, Maharaj. I actually had a little question. when I have the podium. Prabhupada's when he, because at the beginning I didn't announce one of your areas of service is devotee care. And the story you told about Prabhupada, personally going to the hospital to stop the operation, Tom Krishnamurti. I mean, as an example of devotee care, I mean, I'm surprised I haven't heard that before, because that's a really, really beautiful story. But the question is, was Srila Prabhupada correct, or was Tom Krishna Maharaj okay? Did the operation...
I think it was all right. Sometimes you don't know immediately. Like, I had a root canal job done in Bombay. The sweetest devotee, I mean, it's like the best devotee you could imagine, and it seemed fine, but then when I went to South Africa, the dentist there sort of, you know, was probing around, and he said, this is not a proper job, so he redid it. So, long term, I don't know, but immediately there was no difficulty, there was no complication, there was no infection.
Well, that's why we say it's all so nice to have devotees of Maharaj's caliber come that who were there with Prabhupada, and we hear these stories that we may not have heard, and if you have heard them, we haven't heard them like this, devotees who were there. So we very much appreciate Maharaj's coming. So that's all. Once more time, thank Maharaj's coming by three very, very loud Hari Bols.
Hari Bols! Hari Bols! Hari Bols!
Holiness Giriraj Maharaj ki
jai!
And if anybody would like to continue their association with Maharaj in his book form, he has a nice spiritual echo. We have his some books on display here, as I mentioned. Water and the Seed is stories about Prabhupada. So you get to hear his personal experiences with Prabhupada. Then Many Moons, a book about departed Vaishnavas, and the recent book about the Vaishnava attitude towards life's final exam, passing away. So if anybody would like to please take a book, please do. I think somebody will be there now to assist devotees if they'd like to take a book. So thank you very much for coming, everybody. Jai Srila Prabhupada ki
jai.
I'd like to say something about Many Moons. Actually, on the Vaishnav calendar here, today is the appearance day of Srila Shivas Pandit, who's one of the members of the Panchatattva. And it's also the disappearance day of Srila Prabhupada's disciple Sridhar Swami Maharaj. So this book, Many Moons, is, you know, Srila Prabhupada quoted this Chanakya shloka that, you know, one moon can illuminate the whole sky more than thousands of little stars twinkling. So Srila Prabhupada often said that, you know, his mission was to make one moon. And we didn't really know, you know, whether Srila Prabhupada would be successful, but then he himself, in one lecture, he said that, you know, my mission was to make one moon, and now by Krishna's grace, there are many moons. So in this book, I discuss some of those moons, and one is His Holiness Sridhar Swami Maharaj. There are nine, and that Srila Gaura Govinda Swami Maharaj, Srila Tamakrishna Goswami Maharaj, Srila Sridhar Swami Maharaj, Srila Bhakti Sarup Damodar Swami Maharaj, and yes, first His Grace Jayananda Prabhu. He was the first Prabhupada said we should observe his disappearance day every year. And then three from the next generation. There's one Mother Archavigraha, she actually had the idea that there should be a hospice for devotees in Vrindavan. She was from South Africa. And then Mother Kirtida, she was a disciple of Tamakrishna Goswami. She was also from South Africa, but she joined in Dallas and left this world in Dallas. And then a very nice devotee named Abhiram Thakur. He was from Pakistan, actually. And when I was reading about all these sinful places, I was thinking about how devotees had gone to so many of those places. And one of them was Pakistan, where I went and spent a lot of time. So yeah, so those nine are included. And then there's a little piece about Ayendra Prabhu, because he left just when the book was about to go to press, so we just put a little something about him. And now there's so many moons rising and setting. But yeah, so that's the idea of that book. And I thought, because it is Sridhar Swami's disappearance anniversary, to mention that. But actually dealing either directly or hearing about devotees leaving their bodies, so many of them get extraordinary mercy at the end. I mean, it's really amazing. It's really amazing. Like one after the other after the other. Though the nine in the book Many Moons are devotees who pretty much, you know, were steady throughout their whole devotional careers. But in the other book, Life's Final Exam, Death and Dying from the Vedic Perspective, there are some various case histories. And some of them are devotees who you know, had ups and downs in their devotional careers, but in the end they still, you know, they got Prabhupada's mercy and Krishna's mercy, and they had very glorious departures. So it's by going deeply into these cases, you really see how merciful Srila Prabhupada is to anyone who serves him. And that's manifest at the time of death. And Prabhupada had one devotee named Ram Das. He was in a black body. He had been the head pujari in Los Angeles. And he had a very nice motto or principle, which was he didn't worry about taking care of the deities, but he had faith that if he took care of the pujaris, they would take good care of the deities. But anyway, he had a type of degenerative heart disease. And so he came to Vrindavan. And in Vrindavan, he, you know, became very elevated in spiritual consciousness. He lived there with his wife. And I won't go into all the details, but many, anyway, he just became very elevated in Krishna consciousness, and then eventually he left. But after he left, he visited a number of devotees. And the message he gave to all of them was basically the same, which is that you don't know, but you can't imagine how good it is. And whatever, whatever difficulties you have to go through to serve Srila Prabhupada and practice Krishna consciousness, it doesn't matter, because what you get in the end is so good that whatever you have to go through to get there is insignificant. Well, that was his message. And he had full faith in Srila Prabhupada's lotus feet. And before he left, he had, I don't know how many, maybe 200 prints of the impressions of Srila Prabhupada's lotus feet printed. And he made a list of, I guess, 200 people or so. And then he told his wife that after he left, he wanted these sort of, not framed, but in a plastic,
laminate.
Yeah, like laminate, to be given as gifts, Srila Prabhupada's lotus feet. So that really put a very good, gave a nice perspective on what we're doing here and how really small a price it is to pay for what we can get in the end if we just remain faithful to the process and the mode of service. All right, thank you. Hare Krishna. If anyone takes a book, I'll sign it. Okay. Wonderful.